Hi, y'all. I'm Charlie Daniels.
Hi, I'm Charlie Daniels Jr., and this is the Charlie Daniels Podcast. From long-haired country boy to simple man, the best there's ever been. We have had kind of a bumpy road transitioning to video. Told you we would, but there's some things we just didn't know. Like, first of all, we didn't know that all podcast platforms didn't take video. Apple does. We're on Apple. We have a link to our podcast hosting website. They have it on their page for us. But come to find out, Facebook and iHeart both converted the video file we uploaded into something that was strictly audio. And Spotify will take video if your last name is Rogan. Otherwise, they don't take it. In fact, I had to upload separate audio files only to Spotify and to Audible, the Amazon's book reading, books on tape, but they also have podcasts. So we've learned a lot. You need to keep in mind that not everybody is going to see the podcast. So when I reference something like the fiddles, the difference between the fiddles and the violin, I need to realize that not everybody's seeing this. But anyway, I told y'all from the beginning, I'm learning this on the fly and flying by the seat of my pants. So, lesson learned. A lot of you checked out part one of our interview with Chris Young. And I wanted to take the time to thank him for helping us make the jump to video and also to congratulate him on his seven ACM nominations this year. That's more than anybody else in this year. So congratulations, Chris. I'm sure you're going to clean up. Great guy. He deserves it. I also forgot to mention Chris's podcast in the interview coming up. We talked about it, but it's called The Quad with Chris Young. Check it out. And once again, we have reached major milestones from the podcast thanks to you, Dad's loyal fans and listeners. This week, we hit over 675,000 combined downloads of all the episodes. And February is outpacing January, which was our biggest month ever. With 220,000, I accidentally said 225,000 last month and last episode. My mistake. I was off by 5,000, so 220,000. But as of today, we are ahead of January's pace, and February could end up closer to 230,000 or above. So it's just hard to say. But that's all on you. That's on you, Dad's fans. We thank you. Take a bow. You deserve it. And thank you for helping keep Dad's legacy alive. And speaking of keeping the legacy alive, I wanted to talk briefly about what I'm wearing. This is the official CDB 50th anniversary t-shirt and logo. Dad started touring in 1972 as the Charlie Daniels Band. So this year, we are celebrating 50 years of the CDB and, of course, the music. Here's another video interview with Dad. We're going to keep bringing these to you as long as we have archival interviews to share with you.
I'd like for anybody to get out of this book is the same thing that I look for when I read. And I read a lot. I'm a voracious reader, whether I'm reading fiction or fact or biography or whatever. I want to be entertained. I want it to be written in a way that floats, that kind of goes along and carries me along with it and tells a story and relates something of value. And one of the things that I have tried to relate, I have always been kind of a late bloomer. This business I'm in for the most part is a young person's business, especially the recording part of it and the part of it, the recording, trying to keep up with what's going on and that sort of thing. And I came on the scene late. And I would like to encourage people to never think that you're too old to do anything. I think that age taking away some of the physical restrictions that are apt to happen to you or will happen to you as you get older. But I think a lot of it's state of mind. I think you get conditioned to think that at a certain age you're not supposed to do one thing or another, and I think that's a bunch of junk. I say go for it. I did, and that's what I wrote about.
And now a word from our sponsor, the Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project.
Only two things protect America: the grace of Almighty God and the United States military. Words of wisdom from our founder, the late Charlie Daniels. Hi, my name is David Corlew, co-founder of the Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project. From world wars, the Korean conflict, to Vietnam, the Gulf War, and as we experience the drawdown of the 20-year war against terrorism, America has continued to send the best we have into combat, defending the beliefs and the borders of our great nation. When the fighting stops, our men and women who served begin a new mission, their own journey home. The Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project offers assistance and support in the return, the rehabilitation, and the reintegration back to civilian life. We focus on education, housing, various rehabilitation programs, as well as the tragic epidemic of suicide within our own veterans community, 22 a day. Join our mission in serving those who have served us. Donate now by contacting us at the Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project.org. The Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project.org. Thank you and God bless America.
Yes, we're mixing things up this time. But we wanted to talk to you about the website store, because in addition to this beautiful 50th anniversary shirt, we're going to be rolling out a lot more 50-year designs. But we've also got some of our ever-popular designs, like the Devil Went Down to Georgia shirt, the In America lyrics shirt, which has the lyrics in America on the back in the shape of a flag. The Drinking My Baby Goodbye 35th Anniversary shirt. Love that shirt. And of course, Benghazi Ain't Going Away. Dad tweeted that out almost every day since 2012 or 2013. There was a few months, maybe in 2015, that he didn't, but he always strived that once he picked back up, he did it until the day right before he died. And it continues on the website to this day because I'm stubborn and I don't want to let, I want to continue keeping Dad's legacy alive as long as possible. But the Drinking My Baby Goodbye shirts, Drinking My Baby Goodbye koozies we also introduced last year, and the Idle Strings bracelets. If you can see this, this is one of the Idle Strings bracelets. This is one that Angela Wheeler made. She makes all of them by hand. This one was made, it was actually from strings that were used when Dad played at World Outreach Church one year. She made one for me, and she made one for Mom. But they're all made out of strings that were used on stage by the CDB, whether it was Dad, Chris Wormer, or Bruce Brown. They were all used on stage, so you always know you're getting that. And there's a lot of different designs. I'll need to get with Angela here soon and try to come up with some new ones. She's been really busy. I've been busy trying to figure out how to do podcasts. So we will get together soon. But also, by listening to the podcast, we're sharing discount codes for CDB merchandise. This one is the same. Podcast22. Podcast 22, that will save you 30% on your order over $30 at store.charliedaniels.com. Does not apply to the Charlie Daniels Live Fiddle. Chris Young was here. We talked for over 30 minutes, and we could have probably talked a lot more, which is often the times how it happens. But we decided to do what we've done in the past and split it up into two different parts. In this part, some of the glitches that I've been warning about, really, really, really evident here. We have this very, very cool camera system that we use. And what it does, it tracks faces. And so it will have a wide shot where the two of us are sitting there talking. It'll, when it tells that Chris is talking, it'll cut to him. When I'm talking, it'll cut to me. So it's very amazing the technology that is can do all that. But I think due to some lighting problems that we didn't have the studio lit as well as we will the next time we have somebody in here, it started tracking like the painting of Dad, which was above us, the wall. So there's about a 30-second segment about where the camera is kind of bouncing around all over the place, which we just happen to be talking about problems with video. So anyway, it was pretty appropriate. When my girlfriend heard that I was interviewing Chris Young, she informed me that January 25th was Take Your Girlfriend to Work Day. I need to look that up. I'm still not sure to see if that's really a thing. But anyway, here's part two with Chris. You also have been a part of two volunteer jams now, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
Was the first...
I know at least two.
Well, the first one was at the what they call Jam 20, which was actually Jam 19. Don't get me started on all that. But it was, they wanted to call it 20. And so you performed that. I'm pretty sure you did Drinking My Baby Goodbye.
Yeah. I mean, again, that's one of my favorites.
Right.
So I do enjoy playing that one.
Yeah. And then you were also at the what was probably going to be the very last volunteer jam, the tribute jam, the musical salute to Charlie Daniels, and that was an emotional night. It was a great show, and but again, we just appreciate you being part of those, because Journey Home, this podcast. All of the things that, you know, my whole thing is keeping Dad's legacy alive. I keep Dad's social media going, his Twitter account, and the benchmark things that he would do every day, I try to keep going. And one of those things, every time, well, one of them is the 22 veterans, Benghazi ain't going away, remember 9/11, but I always tag them all, keeping Charlie's legacy alive, so it doesn't look like Dad's tweeting from beyond the grave, which I have trolls that come up and say that kind of stuff. But
there's always going to be annoying people on the internet.
Just a few.
That's going to happen. But I think it's fantastic what you're doing to keep the legacy going. And obviously, you know, when I speak about being able to work with the Journey Home project with you guys. The reason that I'm so passionate about it is it is a legacy thing that he started and created. And I just think it's so important and so uplifting to so many veterans and so many people, not just the veterans, people that are their family.
Right.
You know, this is giving outreach and a place to go for some people that really need the help. And, I think it's an amazing thing, and as long as you guys need me to help out, I'll be here.
Yeah, well, we appreciate it. And speaking of social media, Dad was very active on Twitter. Understand from a little birdie that you're pretty active on social media in your own respect, but I'm sure a lot more adept at it than Dad was. I loved Dad to death, but
Some of my stuff is probably just dumber than what he would post. Some of the stuff that I post has no business being on the internet either. I'm just like, I'm bored. I'm going to do something interesting right now.
Well, you know, you got to keep yourself entertained, you know, and if you entertain a few, you know, million followers, you know, then, you know, no harm done. Somebody just pointed out to me, and I didn't realize this, that James Stroud produced some of your early stuff. And you know that he produced Dad's, you know, some of his biggest things on in the late 80s, early 90s, Simple Man being the biggest of all of them. So what was it like working with James?
James is phenomenal. He is like a second dad to me. That any of the stuff that I do that's production related, and I hope I say this and it is not casting a shadow onto his fantastic abilities as a producer. Anything that I've learned, much of it was from him.
Yeah.
And we made 3 records together, including my my second record. Like I told you at the beginning of this, my first record didn't have any hits on it. And then even the second record, we put a song out that was not a hit. And then later we re-released and was a hit, which is wild. But it took like 4 singles, about 4 or 4.5 years before I had a hit, which ended up being a number one with Getting You Home. Was my first number one song. But
great song.
Thank you. Yeah. But that was with James.
Yeah.
And that record, the Man I Want to Be record, was just so special being in the studio with him for so many reasons.
Yeah.
And obviously, if you don't know who James Stroud is, the guy's produced probably a bunch of your favorite country songs.
Yeah.
Most definitely. He's played on a bunch of stuff. Phenomenal drummer as well. It was wild working with him.
Yeah. Did you, have you heard Dad's Bullweevils album? Do you know he produced and he's playing drums on that?
Okay, so this is going to be funny. Were you there when they did the thing at Winners in Nashville?
Yeah.
I was there.
Okay.
I was there, and I was there having, like, late lunch after a co-write.
Yeah.
And I saw people start walking in, and I'm like, I know some of these people, and I saw James, and I'm like, what are you doing here? And he's like,
wearing bib overalls.
And so I got to hear all about the project directly from them.
And which is, again, it's one of my favorite projects, and people that listen to our podcast are probably sick of me talking about it.
Hey, if you haven't listened to it, you're not allowed to be sick of him talking about it. You need to go hear this.
But so I understand that you also do your own podcast, so this is not an uncharted territory for you. So.
No, and we were laughing right before you did this with doing video. We were talking about this was going to be the first week we did video, and we were trying to run something a little bit more complicated than what we're doing right now, and it did not work. we ended up just posting the audio. We were like, sorry, guys, give us one more week to work on this, because it's interesting trying to integrate new stuff and make people happy. And The thing for me is, you know, the podcast is sports, movies, music, and we do a hot take, which is like any dumb argument that you can find that's not literally arguing with each other, but like, is a hot dog a sandwich, and then watch everybody melt down. But it's fun for me.
Yeah.
This is something I enjoy. It seems like it's something that you really enjoy doing. And
well, it is, and I didn't know what I was doing. I said, and again, it's another thing that I've said ad nauseum on this show, is that my original idea for the show was me and Chris Wormer, because Chris, I thought, would bring the performer, stage, road perspective, and I could bring the historical, you know, the growing up with, you know, that perspective and stuff. And I thought between the two of us, we could do a pretty decent podcast. Chris, though, unfortunately, decided that he had to get a big boy job, and so he has gotten his cybersecurity license, and he's
ones and zeros all day long.
So he said, you know, he'd love to do it. He loved the idea, but I found out that if I waited until Chris was going to have time to do it, then this is never going to get done. So I had zero broadcasting experience, zero production experience. Definitely didn't have any video experience. Dad, we bought this Mevo camera for a good friend of ours named David Ballard, who is out in California, one of the smartest guys I know. He had this Mevo camera, and when Dad was performing out in California, he had come to a show, and Dad was like, "What is that?" And so when he saw technology that he liked, even if he didn't understand it, he'd say, "Son, get us one of those." And so we used it only a couple of times, and it had just been kind of sitting around. And the whole thing with the podcast for me was, I need to learn how to crawl before I can walk, or let alone run. So.
This is literally the conversation that we had yesterday. I had one of the guys that does the podcast with me, Ryan, was so frustrated because he was like, I got this, I got the video, I got this. I know how to edit it. And then it just had massive issues. And we really were missing a piece of tech that we needed.
Yeah.
That was a gateway. And he was like, dude, I'm so frustrated. I've been looking at this screen for like 4.5 hours. I cannot figure out why these things are not formatting the right way. Right. And I was like, dude, you got to walk before you can run.
Yep, yep.
I was like, it's okay. Everybody will be okay waiting one more week. It's fine.
So, yeah, the editing part of it, that's a whole other ball of wax because, even if the video is working, I've been trying to get these podcasts out like every couple of weeks. This one might run just a little bit more than the schedule that I set up, but we'll see. Hopefully not. But anyway, when are you back on the road?
Going out really soon. I've actually been nonstop in the studio since the beginning of January.
Awesome.
I completely unplugged for the first time in a long time at the end of December, just because a lot of people see your calendar and they're like, oh, you got a lot less dates, obviously, with the craziness the past couple of years.
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah, but the thing is, like, all of the other stuff, now people are just like, oh, cool, you've got time. Let's cram all of the work things that we normally have to, like, get time for you to do into these open spaces, which has been good in the case of being in the studio, not so good in the case of, oh, well, you've got time to go do this part that's not the part that you want to do music for. But it's just like any, you know, it's unlike any other job. I'm very lucky to have the job I have.
Yeah.
Anybody watching this, thank you very much for my job. I like my job a lot. I've laid brick before. I've dug post holes before. I'm very happy to be doing music. But just like anything, you find the stuff that you really enjoy, and then there's a lot of other work that goes on behind the scenes that may not be seen until the end result of a project or a tour being on sale.
Yeah.
And, 4-hour budget meetings are not the fun part.
Right. I just want to sing.
Yeah, man. Let me get out there and do that. But if that's all you did, then, it wouldn't succeed. But definitely going out this year, have a bunch of stuff that we're adding, and what we're looking to for the end of the year is going to be kind of cool. I can't really talk too much about it, but
What about the new album? When is that?
So the Famous Friends record that we put out, we are looking at adding two.
That just blows my mind now, because that was once used to be once a record was done,
that was it.
No, we're going to add more songs to this record, which is already out. So that doesn't make sense. That just blows my mind.
Well, I mean, we're having the conversation right now is like, do we do a deluxe and then have new stuff ready for the end of the year, beginning of next year?
Yeah.
Do we make it a double album, which I've got enough music to do right now? And we're just kind of toying around with a couple different ideas. For me, being able to be in a world now where when I got started, even just my career, I've been on RCA for almost 16 years now.
That's unheard of.
So I've been on the same label the whole time.
I also wanted to say earlier when you were talking about it that it took you 4 years to have it. That in itself is mind-blowing because a lot of artists, and even for the last, 10 years or more, they put out a song. If it doesn't hit, and they may go with a second one. If that doesn't hit.
Oh, I should have been dropped.
Yeah.
No doubt. I'm serious. He's laughing over in the corner. I should have really and truly been dropped if it wasn't for people going out and buying enough copies of my album for the label to make money.
Yeah.
And keep me around and continue to be, the bank funding me making music and putting me out on the road to go visit radio. I've been to every radio station in the country physically at least like 3 times.
Well, it's funny because that's a not dissimilar to Dad because, Dad was signed to a small label that was actually a division of Buddha Records, which was primarily a black label, soul, R&B label at the time. And Epic CBS Records at the time, now Sony, Epic Records, signed Dad, and you know, the first album, you know, didn't have any big hits. Second album they signed didn't have any big hits. This was 76. 77 didn't have any really big hits. 78. So it wasn't until 79 when Devil Went Down to Georgia came out, and the fact that he was able to get through, you know, 3 or 4, you know, years where he didn't have anything, is you know, unheard of today. That would not have happened today. But mm-hmm. it paid major dividends with Devil Went Down to Georgia, and even and going forward, Full Moon album and everything that followed after that. But it is, I just now made the connection that wasn't too dissimilar to what Dad experienced.
It's a bit of a parallel.
Yeah, a little bit.
I'll take that. Yeah. You know, where I was getting to from that was what we were originally talking about of when I got started, you know, people were still concerned about LimeWire and Napster.
Oh, yeah, like, yeah.
You think about how long ago that was, but everything, you know, transitions into different ways of consumption and different ways people find their music and different ways people engage. And, you know, I've been really lucky to go through a bunch of different phases. And for whatever reason, people still, you know, want to go stream my songs. And
for whatever reason,
new stuff. Hey, I'll take it. Eventually, you know, the thing that every musician has to know at the beginning is no matter, you know, how long, how short, whatever your career is, you know, it's not up to you when people are like, okay.
Yeah.
You'll always have your like really core fan base, but as far as being like popular across a large swath of people, there I've seen too many artist careers of people that still are fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
Where there's just a point in time and it's like, okay, like your big moment of spotlight is done. So I'm gonna enjoy every minute of it.
Well, absolutely, you should. Anything Dad ever said to you, any words that he of wisdom that he you know, gave you that stuck with you or anything like that?
Not even a specific statement, but I'm gonna double down on this. Just him being kind, because you know, everybody's always telling you constantly, like, don't meet your heroes.
Right.
And I can't even imagine the stuff that he had seen and all of the years of knowledge and everything that he'd been through and how long he'd been doing that. For him to remember me and walk up and be like, hey, it's good to see you. Thanks for being here.
Yeah.
At events that I played, meant the world.
He was a great guy. I miss him a lot. Chris, I appreciate you coming out to the sticks out here.
Absolutely, man.
And, you know, hopefully we'll see you again soon, and we'll be looking forward to new music and stuff. And I'm sure you, after the whole pandemic stuff, Dad was just chomping at the bit to get back on the road. So I'm sure that you just being able to get back out there, just it was like, yes, finally.
Oh, yeah. We are, and I say we, like my band, my crew, like all of us are on one big text thread.
Yeah.
And it like every couple of weeks, my guys are like, so, be really good to see y'all soon. and, you know, it's just, that's in your blood.
Yeah.
When you want to go out and perform. And, you know, very excited. I mean, the current single's top 40 now with Mitchell Tenpenny, who's a good buddy of mine. Mm-hmm. Song called At the End of a Bar. That's the shameless plug of this podcast for me.
We're all about shameless plugs here, so.
but, you know, for me, it's just been a couple years of learning to be patient, which is not my skill. That is the thing I'm very weak at. I'm very ADD. I'm very, like, I need to be doing something right now. And being patient and learning, it's just like, man, you control what you can, and the rest of it, if you worry about it, it's not going to do you any good.
Yeah. All right. Well, appreciate it, Chris.
Thank you.
All right. We'll see you.
Chris Young, everybody.
My girlfriend heard that I was interviewing Chris Young. She informed me that January 25th was Take Your Girlfriend to Work Day. I need to look that up. I'm still not sure to see if that's really a thing. But anyway. That fiddle code to save 20% on the live fiddle is Charlie Fiddle, all one word, no spaces, Charlie Fiddle. And those of you who are watching can see the codes on the screen. Sorry for those that aren't getting them except for my voice. But you can get 20% off that fiddle, and it's beautiful. I showed some video of it last time, and here I'm showing it again. It's gold-colored, the engraved pictures of Dad, the engraved signature where Mom and I signed next to, and it's just jam-packed with stuff. I mean, the bandanas, which were used on stage, backstage passes, replica handwritten lyrics, the painted portrait print, which is just stunning, and it's suitable for framing. We also had the Full Moon Button, the Live from Iraq poster. It's just jam-packed with extras. The fiddle bows that we found that were being prepped for the road, those we added to it, and autograph photos. So, and there's an autograph book of Dad's soapboxes. So there's a lot of stuff in here, and we are really kind of getting down to the nitty-gritty on these. So just wanted to share that with you. It really is the ultimate gift for the ultimate CDB fan. You can get them at store.charliedaniels.com. I think everyone really enjoyed hearing Dad read from his book last time. And we've got another one. So we have one more that was on the camera. And, you know, we played one last week. We have another one from a different Facebook Live session that we did. So anyway, here's Dad once again.
This is called Turn It Loose. There's a Bible verse that goes in front of every section and a little witticism afterwards. And the Bible verse today is, do not let the sun go down on your wrath. And that's Ephesians 4:26. Have you ever taken a grudge to bed with you? I have, and I never intend to do it again. Sleep and anger make incompatible bedfellows. The anger usually turns to thoughts of getting even and paying back in kind. The plotting can go on until the wee small hours, and when the sun rises, you're accomplished absolutely nothing except depriving yourself of a good night's sleep. There's a mechanism to release the release valve for you to turn it off. The grudge does not get the best of you. It's called forgiveness. Forgiveness works like this. You don't have to condone a wrongful act, but if you want to have peace in your life, you do have to forgive it. After all, your thoughts are not really hurting anybody but you. Put aside thoughts of vengeance and harm. Take a deep breath, forgive. Let it go with the knowledge that it's not your place, but God's place to make all things right. Conversely, if you are the offender, it's your place to ask the person you offended for forgiveness. If you do that before your sun goes down, you'll get a much better night's sleep. Taking ill feelings to bed with you is like trying to sleep with a cactus plant. Holding on to a grudge is a little like holding a tiger by the tail. It's going to eventually turn and consume you.
Now that we're doing video, I'm going to have to go through some older live streams to see if we have any more of Dad reading from Let's All Make the Day Count. I don't know that we do. I know we do have a few things of him reading from Never Look at the Empty Seats, which we might do that. But, you know, if we find another one, I will definitely keep everybody posted. And if you would like to read more of Dad's Daily Words of Wisdom, you can go to charliedaniels.com/book. Follow the links there. We'll get you to where you can download the audiobook, which I read. Unfortunately, it wasn't Dad. You get the second generation Charlie Daniels to do it. And if you want to read it the old-fashioned way, we have those at store.charliedaniels.com as well. Okay, since last Sunday was the you know what? Unless you're an official NFL sponsor, you're really not supposed to say Superb Owl. That's the closest you can kind of get to it. Or just say the big game. So anyway, since the big game was this past weekend, I thought I would tell you one of my favorite memories with Dad. We were in Jacksonville, Florida, January 2007 for Big Game 39. Bridges was the theme because Jacksonville was the city of bridges. There's a lot of bridges there. So they used bridges as a metaphor to bridge the age gaps between some of the performers they had. So they had performers that were hot currently and their influences, bridging the gap. So like Black Eyed Peas performed with Earth, Wind, and Fire. And they had also invited Gretchen Wilson to perform. Well, you know, Gretchen, her career was hot as a firecracker. That first album she had, where she said that she knew all the words to every Charlie Daniels song, it made it a perfect opportunity. She wanted her hero, Dad, to be the performer with her. So he had a combination of CDB and Gretchen's band on stage. Gretchen sang Here for the Party, came out, introduced Dad, you know, smoke went off, Dad came out and played. And so it was a great atmosphere. I was on the field for it. It was just, you know, the energy. Devil Went Down to Georgia was on the ribbon band around the stadium. And, you know, Black Eyed Peas and Earth, Wind, and Fire, they closed out the performance, but they everybody went on stage. So Dad and Gretchen went on to the stage where they had been performing. And one of the Black Eyed Peas took Dad's hat and put it on. That may not have been the best thing, but Dad took it all in stride. But anyway, it was just an amazing atmosphere. And as much as I enjoyed that, that was not my favorite memory. No, it was after the performance. We are walking back to the... They had a suite for us to use for the rest of the game. Paul McCartney was the halftime show. And then, of course, there was the game, which was New England versus Philadelphia. And anyway, it was just... You know, we were on our way back to the suite when security stopped us and said the presidents were coming through for us to just hold here. Well, the presidents were Bill Clinton and George H.W. Bush, who were touring around together a lot as almost a presidential odd couple, for lack of a better word. I mean, they were, you know, it was kind of strange, but they were making a lot of appearances together. So saw Bill came around the corner first. He started working the back of the room, and we saw George W. Bush Sr., George H.W. Bush, came through. And, you know, Dad and I talked, and I asked him if we might be able to get a picture together. Well, at the very last second, Bill must have turned around, because it looks like he is photobombing us, like, hey, y'all, you know, don't forget about me. Don't you want me in the picture too? And so, and it almost looks like a cardboard cutout. I've had people say that it looks like a cardboard cutout. And if those of you who are watching this, you can see the picture. But anyway, so it was just hilarious that, you know, for that. And that's still not my favorite memory of the whole thing. So anyway, we all lingered and talked a few more minutes, and then you know, eventually, you know, they moved on. We went to the suite, and I was walking kind of close to Gretchen, and I heard Gretchen make this sound, like, ugh! I was like, what? What's wrong? And she just said, Bill Clinton would not let go of my hand. And just in my typical fashion, I said, yeah, and you don't know where that hand's been. And she was like, I know. So that I will never forget those superb memories. But this does bring up an important problem for the NFL. The past two seasons, the winner of the big game has played in their home stadium and won last two seasons in a row. It's never happened before. I never thought one team would play
big game
in their home stadium, let alone win it in my lifetime. But it's happened 2 years in a row. And from what I understand, the NFL is very upset about this. They want to make sure it never happens again. So from here on out, all
big games
are going to be played at AT&T Stadium. That's from my brother, Bill Wolfenbarger. Love you, Bill. That's all we got time for today. For all the latest news on all things CDB, the podcast, merchandise, new releases, which hopefully we will have some coming up soon, go to charliedales.com and be sure to subscribe so you get to see my face again. Those of you who are watching on Apple Podcasts or from the link on the podcast page. But anyway, this is Charlie Daniels Jr. Let's all make the day count. And don't forget, Benghazi, it ain't going away. And neither is Afghanistan.